Begin the current daf Masechtas Yumin daf Lamed Vav. We begin on the bottom of Lamed Hema Beis, full ends up at the bottom of the Yamed. We continue with the series of the Avodas of Havu Yoyma, the name of this Masechta of the Avoda of the Kohen Gadol on that day, which is when he switched. We already spoke about the first of the five Avodas of doing Big Dizav, the regular daily sacrifice of the Tumen and all those other things, Kedaris. And then we spoke about in the previous Mishnah how he put on his Big Dizav. And we continue regarding that Avoda of the Big Dizav and regarding the specifics of Avoda to this day of Yom Kippur. Shiris Kospans Bekazuk Necheskot Tuanit Abdabachem Bisham Tuanit Zutayiz Daf Shiris Kospans Tuanit Ben Yehudis Begans Kalal Yisrael and Meretz Yisrael. Some of the things we discuss in today's Daf are the Gemara discusses the Halacha of Kutcha Kutchim Shkutasim Atzafim. Just that we know that the holiest carbonates have to be slaughtered in the Tzafim, as it says in the Pasuk Meshachat Es HaYerech HaMzbech Tzafayna. Now, three opinions. What exactly is the Iri considered tzafen? We'll see that the right side, essentially, when you come in, is tzafen. But what exactly, where is considered tzafen? It's not necessarily the whole tzafen. We discuss smicha, that you have to lean on the carbon, and for what a carbon oila atones for, because that and all the other karbanas. And as you lean on the carbon, you have a vidui, and specifically the vidui of the Kohen Gadol Yom Kippurim, the order of saying shavisi, v'shabashati, v'shabotas, which actually is machlekes regarding what's the appropriate order. And the concept of lava netik lase. Lava netik lase is a negative prohibition which could be ameliorated, could be fixed with a subsequent positive commandment. The halacha is in like in love, and we have a machlekes exactly how far is the parameters of saying something is considered lava netik lase. Egla rufa is the calf that gets decapitated, which is when you find a dead person somewhere on the road, you don't know who killed them. The pasuk says, Yudenu l'shavchas b'mazeh b'nin l'ro, we didn't see, and they say we didn't send him without any food or without escorting him. But the pasuk says that Kapal Amchi Sol Shapatis Hashem Al Tita Dam Naki Bekabecha. The judges come and they say there should be an atonement. We have a discussion exactly what is the statements that are said by the Egla Rufa. So we begin the current daf, like we said, daf Lamed Vav on the bottom of Lam Hema Beis. Four lines of the bottom here. But we continue with Halacha the next Mishnah. Continue on the Avodas Hayoyim of the Kohen Gadol with the white garments. So it said Bala Itzel Parai. So he already tabled and it comes to his bowl. There's his own private family has a par. We know the par and the sar, two of these karbanos, the dam is thrown inside the kodesh hakodeshim. The par is his own for him and his family, and then the sar is for the ganz kol Yisrael. For the that's the sar lashem. So he would come to his par. Now where was his par that he was coming to it? Upar hayo amid ben ulam mizbeach. His par was between, as you can see, this is the ulam, this is the mizbeach, or over here if you like these types of pictures, this is the ulam, this is the mizbeach. So he came to that area where his bull was between the antechamber and the altar. Roshay Ladara. So you had the head of the animal was facing towards the south. This is the north over here, or if you come here on this picture, this is the north and this is the south. So the head was towards the south. Upon of Lamayr, but actually its head was towards the east. Now the Gemara is going to explain how that's possible. It's because they actually bent the head of the animal towards the heichal. So the Gemara is going to say, "Why? Like, why don't you just do it straight? Simple. Just have the tail towards the east and the head towards the west. Why do you have to have it from running from north to south and then turn it towards the west? Why don't you just have it from east to west?" But the Gemara is going to discuss exactly why it was that way. Now the Kohen Oimid b'Mizrach. The Kohen, he stood in the east, as this picture illustrates, where his back is towards the west. Upon the Lamayr, and his face was towards the west, which is facing towards the Heichel. He leaned his two hands on the animal, and he said the Vidui, the confession for him and his family. That's what he said. On the Hashem, please Hashem, Avisi, we sinned willfully. Peshati, I sinned rebelliously. Then he's saying in the singular, because going on him. Chatos levenach, I sinned in front of you. Those are three different terminologies we'll explain in the Gemara. Avisi, Peshati, and Chatosi. Ani obeisi, me and my family, on the Hashem, please Hashem, which actually Tais brings that from the Yerushalmi. The first one is on the Hashem, and the second one actually is on the Bashem, because the first one was actually referring to the name, and the second one actually was Bashem. He said it with the name, with the Shem HaMafar. And actually, that's how we say it, on the Bashem, because that's when we say Baruch Shem. If you notice, sometimes we say, and the davening Baruch Shem is sometimes not, because here it's on the Bashem. Kaperna, atone, please, la'avoinais, la'psham, la'chatoim, for these three different types of sins, willfully, rebelliously, and by mistake. Shavisi, v'shabashati, v'shachatos, la'venach, anivez, again, that I had sinned willfully and rebelliously and by mistake, me and my family. Kakosim, says Moshe Abdecha, like it says in the Torah of Moshe, your servant, in v'yikro, kibiyim, as a yichap, like it says, in this day it will be atonement to purify you from all your sins in front of Hashem. The people would respond afterwards when they heard the shame of a fire is Bashem, they would respond, Baruch Shem, blessed is the name, Kavoy Machuzah, which is the glory of his kingdom, Loilam Vaad, forever and ever. We begin the Gemara on Lamavam and Aleph, which the Gemara explains a specific of the halach of our Mishnah. We said that where you're going to do this, that you're going to have the kain come to his power, is Beinu Ulam Umlebrech. Says the Gemara, Mat Shamali, which Tana is it? That's the Tana of our Mishnah that we learned. The Amma that he says, Beinu Ulam Lemizbeach, the area between the antechamber and the Mizbeach, that is called Tzafin. It's called the north. Man, what do you mean the north? That is the north. Right? North, east, we all know what directions are. It's the north. Now it's called the north for the halacha of slaughtering kachi kachim, which is from the halfway point of the Heichel towards the north. In this area, Beinu Ulam Lemizbeach, which if you're configuring measurements, when you're locating an area, so you want to consider all the different points on either side. So from the Heichel, the midpoint of the Heichel, to further out was considered, that was the north part of the Azar. Now, however, moving downwards towards the area between the Mizbeach, that area, okay, that would be considered the northern part of, why not? That seems to be the north. If you split the Azar in half, put in the quadrants, this from the Heichel was in the middle, the door was in the middle. So moving towards the right, that of course is going to be the north. But as we'll shortly see, no, it's not necessarily the case. But in our Mishnah said that the power is between the Mizbeach. There's a Mishnah later on that the Malbim Beis says that wherever he said the Vidui was exactly where they did the Shechita. Like it says, Bolei Tzalpari Shnei came a second time to his power, and he leaned his two hands on it, and he shefted it, and he received the blood. So it was in exactly where he did the Vidui, it was exactly where they did the Shechita. So who's the Tanavah Mishnah that holds that you're going to be shefting it over here? This area, I want you to know, is not by the Mizbeach. It's not opposite the Mizbeach this way. If you're coming from east to west, this is right by the side of the Mizbeach. A little further is Beinu Ulam Mizbeach. You're not on the side of the Mizbeach. You have to think from a few different directions, just make sure everyone gets that clear, because we're not talking about, when you say Beinu Ulam Mizbeach, we mean to say you're further than the Mizbeach. It doesn't mean Beinu Ulam Mizbeach means this way, Beinu Ulam Mizbeach. It means this way, meaning coming from east to west. We don't necessarily mean between north and south. Actually, more later we'll clarify that for sure, that's what it means. But we're talking about from east to west, you're already past the side of the Mizbeach, and now you're between the Mizbeach and the Ulam. Who is it that holds that will qualify, yeah, you're in the northern part, but who is it that will qualify as, quote, Tzafin? Says the Gemara, it's actually three machlekes, and Rebbe Elazar b'Shimon, it's going like Rebbe Elazar b'Shimon, the Tanna Gluna b'Raisa. Ezo Tzafin, what's considered Tzafin? Again, all these areas, once you pass the midpoint of the Heichel, you're already Tzafin, but not necessarily would that qualify as the north, for we could check the country, kachim. The first opinion says, Mikir Shem Mizbeach Tzafini, from the wall of the northern wall of the Mizbeach, that Kreis Lazar until the walls of the Azara, or Keneged Kol Mizbeach Kulin, opposite that a whole entire area of the Mizbeach, meaning the 32 Amos of the width of the Mizbeach, going to the north, that's called Tzafin, for Shechting, for slaughtering country, kachim. But if it's, let's say, not opposite the actual Mizbeach itself, let's say either further to the west or further to the east, even though it's quote-unquote, like I was explaining all along, it's Tzafin Azar, it's all the northern part of Azar, that's not considered called Tzafin for Shechita. Why not? Because the Pasuk has another variable, another criterion. It has to be Al Yerech HaMizbeach. Al Yerech is like the thigh, the side of the Mizbeach. Like I said, V'shachat HaSiyah Al Yerech HaMizbeach. Tzafina. So, yes, although this whole area is all Tzafin, but it has to be Yerech HaMizbeach. So therefore, Divrei Beis Behuda, he holds that actually the Irbet Ulam Mizbeach is not valid, because that's not Yerech HaMizbeach. So that won't consider as called Tzafin. But Rav Elazar b'Shimon Maitz, if he adds on, and that's what we're saying, he's the Tana of our Mishnah, he adds on Av Bein Ulam Mizbeach. Even the area a little bit further to the west, between the antechamber and the Mizbeach, that whole area towards the west is also considered Tzafin, even though not literally the Yerech. That's also considered all Yerech HaMizbeach. Now, but let's say the northern part towards the east of the Mizbeach. No, that I would agree. That would have been considered as tough, and you can't check the country kashm over there. Rebbe adds on even more. He says, the whole northern part of the Azara, even in the 11 Amis of Malkum Drisa Zagli Kahanim, which is further east, that's where specifically Kahanim were able to walk, and the Af Malkum Drisa Zagli Israel, and even all the way to the eastern wall of the Azara, where there's the 11 Amis where even a non-Kohen could walk, all of that is considered the Tzafin Azara to do the Shechita of Kachi Kachi. Now, Aval, but, Min HaChalifas V'Lefnim, from the area of the Chalifas and within, meaning to say, that this picture which is the Hegel. Now, adding on either side of the Hegel, you had a width of 15 Amis going to the north and 15 Amis going to the south. That extension is only an area of 11 Amis going from east to west. And that extension was called the Beis HaChalifas, which in there, there were 24 windows. Every single mishmar, there was 24 mishmaris that did the avodah in the Beis HaMikdash throughout the year. Each of them had a special window where they would put their holy knives that they used for the avodah. And that's what's called Beis HaChalifas, because in Lashon Arvi, a sakin is called a chiluf. So that's called Beis HaChalifas. It's essentially where they had their knives. Now, the ear space, which was behind it towards the west, and even actually the area over here, which you can't necessarily see so well, but let's say behind the Beis HaChalifas itself, that was all considered Lefnim HaChalifas, and that area, everyone agreed, that's not considered Yakum Zev, because you couldn't even see, HaKol Moed Mishapasal, everyone agrees that's invalid, because since the Mizbeach cannot be seen over there, you can't call it Yerech Mizbeach. Meaning, Yerech Mizbeach doesn't have to be Mamish exactly, according to some opinions, but it has to be at least that you could see it. Here, where it's been Beis HaChalifas Lefnim, you can't even see it. Okay, so that's everyone agrees not going to be the same. But one thing says the Gemara. So who's the time?
Which side? Yerech Mizbeach
Tzafon. The side of Mizbeach towards the north. So the question is it Azoi Pinklich Gizot? Yerech Mizbeach, it has to be exactly, or Yerech Mizbeach on the side, on the northern side. It doesn't have to be exactly right behind. So that's the Machlek is exactly how far do we say that is. But basically, you can't even see the Mizbeach, you can't call that Yerech Mizbeach. Right, there's machlokes exactly where the Mizbeach actually was. But let's say we're saying it over here, it doesn't make a difference really, but it means on the northern part, where it's on the side of Mizbeach, on that side. So one thing is, we see that who's the time of Mishnah, it's like Rabbi Elazar Rabbi Shimon. Because he says, from the Iri Ben El Mizbeach is considered the northern part. According to Rabbi Yosef Yehuda, it's not. So says the Gemara, but Lema, let's say that you were specific when you said Rabbi Elazar Rabbi Shimon, V'loi Rebbe, and you didn't say it's Rebbe. So says the Gemara, no, I feel a tamed Rebbe. Of course, we could even be like Rebbe. We were saying it's even like Rebbe Elazar Shimon, but of course it could be like Rebbe. And the Gemara says, the whole hashtag Rebbe, at the Rebbe Yisrael, Rebbe Yehuda, myself, he adds on to Rebbe Yisrael, Rebbe Yehuda, that you could go ahead and go even further to the east. At the Rebbe Elazar Shimon, like myself, you don't think he's adding on to Rebbe Elazar Shimon? In other words, what's your question? Of course it's not specific when we said it's like Rebbe Elazar Shimon. Is it possible that Rebbe adds on that's what's considered Tzafon? He allows even further to the east, which is further from the sanctity of the Hegel. And what, in Rabbi Yisi, that he's adding on, but Rabbi Elazar, Rabbi Shimon, who says you could do Ben El Mizbeach, he's not going to be adding on? How's it possible to say that he would hold further away is going to be kosher, but closer is going to be possible? You're telling me he holds further east is kosher, all the way with the Mokum Dries is Rakhul Khan, Mokum Dries is Rakhul Yisrael, and what? And Ben El Mizbeach he would hold is Nishkosher? How can he say that? Of course he's going to hold as considered Yerech Mizbeach Tzavainim. So of course he could be the Tana by Mishnah. Says Gemara, no, it's not necessarily the case. Anan Hachi Karmina, this is what we're saying. In other words, of course, yes, according to Rebbe, for sure he himself would hold, Ben Ul Mizbeach would be considered Tzafon. That this that we're saying that maybe the Tana by Mishnah is not like Rebbe, the reason why we had this question, this difficulty, was to say maybe the Tana by Mishnah does not hold like Rebbe, that holds that the whole Azara, that on the northern part is Kasher, so how could it be he wouldn't be like Tana by Mishnah? We were saying like this, if you think the Tana by Mishnah is like Rebbe, so then why is it that the Tana said that you have to bring the power of the Kohen Gadol so close that should be between the Ul Mizbeach? I mean, put it anywhere in the northern part, Bakulas or in the whole Azar, wherever you want to. Why are you picking specifically Ben Ul Mizbeach? Must be Holy Grail Lazar Shimon. Because, like Rebbe, why would you say that? Just say anywhere in the Tzav would be good. That's why we said maybe it's not like Rebbe. So the Gemara says, I don't understand. So that's not a good Ryan, because Elamai, then what's the case? Rabbi Elazar Rabbi Shimon. So you want to say, so who's the time? Rabbi Elazar Rabbi Shimon. But if that's the case, you still have a difficulty. And put it between the Mizbeach and the wall over there on the northern part of the Azara, because according to everyone, the primary Tzafon is Yerech Mizbeach, literally opposite, like Rabbi Yehuda holds. So even though he validates also Ben El Mizbeach, but why wouldn't you put it specifically right opposite the Mizbeach? Elamai Slechol Memer, rather, what do you have to say? Why did they make it so much closer to the Hegel? They put it there Ben El Mizbeach. Hashem Chosh the Kohen Gadol, because of the weakness of the Kohen Gadol, it shouldn't be so hard on him that he has to go ahead and take the load of the bowl of the blood so far because he has to go into the Hegel. He has to get into the Kachar with his power, the Dam of his power. So he made it easier, so he made it as close as possible. He doesn't have to travel with it so long. So if that's the case, and that's why we said it'd be Nil Mizbeach, even though it's like Reb Elazar ben Shimon, that of course the primary would be along the northern wall of the Mizbeach, so then the Rabbi Nami. So you're right. According to Rabbi, even though the whole Azara, the northern part is kosher, but we're going to bring it as close as possible to the Hechem Shem Chosh, the Kohen Gadol, because of the weakness of the Kohen Gadol. So therefore, not necessarily only like Reb Elazar ben Shimon, of course it could even be like Rabbi, because he validates the whole thing. So then why do we pick specifically over here? To make it easy on the Kohen Gadol, not to carry so much a heavy load on Yom Kippur. Now, we said in the Mishnah, Reish L'Adar, we said, so the head of the animal, meaning the front, is facing towards the south, and the Panav L'Mayav, but its head, its face, is towards the west. So it's going to be Hechem Mishkav, that doesn't work. How could you have the head one way and the face another way? So it's going to be Amar Rav, he says, Boikim is Reish. So will you turn his head? So that's how you could have that his head, is the front is facing one way, the face is going to be another direction. So it says, but why do you do it such a funny way? Why don't you do it straight? Have the back towards the east, and then have the face towards the Hechel, if that's what you want to have. Why are you having it one direction and twisting the head? So Mabaye says, no, Gzeret's a concern, Shemi Yarbitz Kololim. Maybe the cow is going to release excrement, and it's disgraceful to show its disgraced part towards the side where the Mizbeach is. So it's better to have the tail towards the north and the head towards the south. So it comes out that really even the tail wasn't even opposite the Mizbeach, because they didn't pull it all towards the south, the whole length of the cow. It's only part of the body that was bein ul Mizbeach. But actually the tail wasn't even between ul Mizbeach. So let alone for sure not going to have its rear facing Mizbeach, but we didn't even have the front part of it. We didn't have the whole animal, even partially even. That was actually sticking out. We only had part of it sticking in, and that's why we had it that way, but we wanted the head to face that way. But the reason why we didn't have it this way, we didn't want to have the rear facing that way, and also we didn't even want it at all in that area. Now, turn around in the Braisa, continue on this theme regarding the halacha of the direction of the animal, and also in general regarding as they did smicha, says the Braisa, kitzad seimach. In regards to any kachim, when they would be leaning on the animal, and they would do their confession, how do you lean on the animal? So it says the Raisa, Hazevach emid bitzafon. So the carbon itself, as we said, was actually in the north, because all kachim needed the north. Upon the Blamayr, and its face was towards the west, and here that you could have its rear towards the east. Don't know why this picture is like this. The rear should be the rear is to the east because it's not ben ul Mizbeach. So it's okay to have its rear. We're not doing ul Mizbeach. This is it's only by the power of the Kohen Gadol. Regular kachim was just in the northern part of the Azara. And you had its rear to the east, and you had its face towards the west. Vasaymich, and the owner who's leaning on it, he's Oymid b'Mizrach. He stands in the east with his back towards he's standing in the east, meaning with his back to the east. Upon the Blamayr, and he's facing towards the west, towards the direction of the Hechel. V'menich shteyod ben shtei koronish al zevach, and he puts his two hands between the two horns of the animal. He has to make sure that there's no chatzitz, there's nothing interposed between him and the animal. So he's leaning on the animal with his hands. Mitzvada, and he confesses, so al chatas, when he's bringing a korban chatas, he confesses al chatas, the sin, whatever sin he did that made him bring in the korban chatas. Va'ashem, which is certain types of unique karbanas that they bring a guilt or a finger, of an ashem, you confess whatever the sin of the ashem is. Va'ayla, if let's say he's bringing a korban ayla, so what is he confessing in ayla? Is oven leket shik chlopeo meiser ani. For the sin of leket, shik chlopeo, leket is those gleanings that fell off that you have to leave for the poor that you took, or shikha is those bundles that were forgotten you have to leave for the poor, or payers, the corner of the field, or maisa'ani, which is the tithing of the poor people, which Rashi says the reason why we're putting this in one category is that these things don't have vidui, which Taisa adds on, it doesn't have its own vidui, but from the atzma at least, even though maisa'ani is mentioned somewhere. So the chiddush, actually, why we're picking specifically these cases is there's many lavim hanitik le'essay, there's many negative prohibitions that can be ameliorated, and there's no other punishment for it, that for those types of things you're bringing a korban ayla. The reason why I picked these things is because it's actually coming to tell us a chiddush that these things are nitik le'essay, because that's actually the next man d'amr who disagrees. But different basically, he's saying that these things are, essentially, it's really any negative prohibition that doesn't have any punishment, because if it does, you bring a chatas or ashram, whatever it is, it doesn't have any. Because it's nitik la'asei, which Taisa discusses what's with all the other lavim that don't have any punishment, because lav shebechlolas, that's not included. So specifically like a lav nitik la'asei, like these things, which you're not supposed to take the lek, you're not supposed to take a sheikha pay, but you don't get a chatas or ashram, there's no other punishment. So for that, you bring a korban ayla, and you confess that sin. Rabbi Akiva, he says, which sounds like the same thing, but the Gemara is going to show that they're disagreeing. He says, no, ein oila ba. He says, the carbon oila does not come for, let's say, krisis or mises bezdin, because that the Torah already says the punishment. And if it's coming for a lisa, say, the Torah already says the punishment, you get malchus. So what's an oila? When do you bring a carbon oila? It only comes, illa ala say, if you violate a positive commandment, where there's no punishment for that. And while loisa say, shenitik la say, or a negative prohibition that can be fixed with a subsequent positive commandment, which let's say you steal, okay, you do return the theft. There's many negative prohibitions that you could ameliorate, you could fix it, where you don't get lashes. In contrast to leket shechem peya, which according to Rabbi Akiva, he considers that actually he disagrees, and that's why we basically picked those cases, because Rabbi Akiva disagrees and holds that no, that's a lesser segama. It's not because of love and ethic lesser. So this is my commitment for you. So what are they disagreeing about? Meaning they all agree that oily comes for assay or a lesser and ethic lesser. So why is he basically picking those cases that Rabbi Akiva seems to disagree and holds that those things are not considered a love and ethic lesser? So maybe he says it's a kingdom of base, he says it's beloved in the veil commitment. They're disagreeing about regarding the qualification of like places discussed of why we're picking this case, but like the negative prohibition of a nevela. A nevela, a person is forbidden to be eaten. Now, after the halacha of nevela is mentioned, it says afterwards a positive commandment. It says in Devarim Yudalad, you know what you should do with it? Give it to the ger with the ger toishav and balchala, he'll eat it. Now, as Rashi explains, obviously that's not a lavanitic lasse. It's not like, oh, if you steal, return the theft, because you can't give it to the ger toishav. You already just ate it. You violated the law of eating an avela. So obviously this essay of give it to the ger means beforehand, don't eat any nevela, rather first give it to the ger and don't eat it. So on that, let's say that lab of nevela, which subsequently says in essay, we have a machlekes Rabbi Akiva and Rabbi Yisai Glili. Kiva Sabi holds lav malyum. There's a bona fide negative prohibition, which if you violate and you got one, you're gonna get lashes. Now, so to the lav of leket shekapeya also says a positive commandment after it says the lav. Now, obviously, it means beforehand. So the pasuk in Vayikra test says leket ketzirch leisalakid, rather lo ani tazveno and don't be malakid. So if someone violates and he takes a leket shekapeya, according to Bekiva, you're gonna get lashes. And of course, the oil is not coming for that because it's a regular negative prohibition, which you're getting a punishment. Oil is only when there's no other punishment. But for basically the savar, and that's why he picked those examples, he holds no lav lav ma'aliyu. It's not a right. It's lav lav. Lav lav ma'al, it's not a negative, a bona fide negative prohibition, like the lav of an avelo, even though obviously, as Rashi explains, that the subsequent assay, of course it has to mean initially, because you can't say it's really saying you fixed the negative prohibition by doing it because you really ate it, but since it's written afterwards, simply because it's written after the lav of an assay, so you're not going to get lashes, why not? Because it's not similar to the lav of chasima. The lashes are written by, we learned that the negative prohibitions from chasima of muzzling the animal. So it has to be similar to that. Now, a chasima doesn't have a subsequent positive commandment. So although here it's not really a nitik lassay, but it's written afterwards as an assay, and therefore, you're not going to go ahead and have any punishment of lashes, so therefore you're going to go ahead and bring an oil for it. So do the lav like shechabeya. Even though the subsequent assay obviously means that you should do it beforehand to give it to the poor people, but you're not going to get lashes simply because it has an assay afterwards. So it's interesting. It's not really your classic love and nitik lassay, because not really nitik lassay. You can't really fix it. You already took the leket. You already ate the nevela. But the nice it says afterwards an assay. So basically holds that would also be included in the exemption of a negative prohibition, and you wouldn't get lashes. So then what are you going to do with it? Then you're going to bring an oila. That's their machlekes on those types of cases. That's one interpretation. Abayam, he disagrees on Yirmi's interpretation. He says, no, the kulam, according to everyone, lav de nevela, the negative prohibition by eating not kosher, an animal that was not properly slaughtered, obviously the subsequent mitzvah saseh, of course it means initially, and therefore lav ma'al yahav, of course it's the bond of a negative prohibition, it's not nitik lassay, there's no nothing here, and of course you get lashes. So that's, he's saying that's not true. There everyone agrees you're going to get lashes. But v'hach over here, so what's the machlekes regarding matnas anim, regarding leker, chif, and peyah? What's the machlekes, and why is he basically saying that you bring an oil on that, if it's not now at lav nitik lassay, like you're saying by nevela? Here it's specifically betaziv, where it says there's a pasuk after the negative prohibition of leket shekapeya, it says tazid, leave it for the poor. That's the kamifuki they're disagreeing regarding how to translate that word. Rabbi Akiva Sabah, he holds tazid means mikar mashma, meaning from the beginning. Before you take it, the positive commandment is telling you to leave it. But if you didn't leave it, you're going to get a negative prohibition and you're going to get lashes because, again, it's not nitik lassay. And then you're not going to make a carbon oil. But Reb Yitzchak Lilus of a Hashta Mashma. He reads Hashta in the Tazit in the present tense. After you already took it, you violated negative prohibition. Yeah. It's Nitik Lasse. Go put it back. Put it Tazit. Leave it. Shenge Nimit. Like a Siddiq. That's what he's saying. Oh, it is Nitik Lasse. And therefore, you're not going to get lashes, and therefore, so you're not getting lashes. So what do you do? So it is appropriate to bring a carbon oilam on the lekachik of paying the matnas aniyim. That's their maflik. Is again, it seems like a technicality because they both agree really what the parameters of the oil is coming from. We only brought the brayas in, if you recall, because we're talking about the vidur of the kohen gadol of kippurim. So we said, how do you do the vidurim on all other animals, the shechatas, the ashim, oila? Everyone agrees it's my essay and lava nitik lasse. The maflikus was exactly what would be considered lava nitik lasse. Either it's an interpretation of music, really he holds that. Even though it's not really nitty, as long as the essay says after that. Well, no, of course he agrees that's nitty essay. The question is, tazim, does tazim mean like a keyboard from the beginning? Or does it mean right now, leave it, and therefore you could fix it, and therefore you're not going to get lashes, therefore it's going to be in the category of bringing a carbon oil on that. Now, we continue with the aloha of our Mishnah, which we said that the, what was the wording of the vidui? We say it's one of the great things that we say in Yom Kippur, in the davening, that these, the vidui of the Kohen Gadol. So we learn the brayse kitzim mizvada. How did he confess on his par and his bowl? So he'd say a visi, peshati, v'chatosi. In that order is how he would say the confession. And the truth is, b'chem misar mishalecho and so too, not only by his par, but also by the he-goat that was sent off the cliff. That there also it was said first avoynis, then b'sham and mechatan. The pasuk of Yikra. Mizvada loves kol avoynis bnei yisrael, and you'll confess on misar hamishalech, misar la'azazel, all the sins of the Jewish people. So it says avoynis first. But kol b'shem and all their wanton sins, their rebellious sins. L'chol chataisim for all their mistaken sins. And v'chem b'meishu, and v'sot b'meishu, it says in Shemayis, when it talks about the Yudgim Amidus, Hashem's 13 attributes of kindness, Hashem is noisy avoin, v'fesha, and v'chato. That's different Meir Meis. So you see, that's the order. First you talk about avoinus, which are deliberate sins, then pesha, which are wanton, rebellious sins, and then chato, which is that of a mistake. Now v'chamam, they disagree. They says, wait a second, Remei, avoinus ilah zedoinus. What's an oven? An oven is a deliberate sin. Chino, I mean, I'll prove to you, says about midrash, he cars the cars and nefesh he avoin aba. Who gets cars? Which is only if you do deliberate sin. There's a guy who is avoin aba, who has his sin in him. Now, psham, what's that? Elam radim, that's rebellious, who does it deliberately to anger. Chino, like it says about melachim beis, melach moiv pashami, the king of moiv, he rebelled against me. You see, the word pesha means rebellious. Chino, like it says about the as tifsha livna beis ahi, that the dwellers of Libna, they rebelled on the king of Judea. At that time, you see, tifsha is a terminology of rebelliousness. Now, l'chol chatoisim, for all their chatois, what's that? Ela shkogis, that's when you do it by mistake. Like it says in Meikra, nefesh kisef to b'shkoga, when the soul is going to sin, chato, b'shkoga, by mistake. So the chum sin to says, I don't understand. U'me'achash is v'ada alaz doin is v'ala me'radin. You tell me the order is first avoinus, then p'sham, then chato. So you already confessed for deliberate sins, for rebellious sins. Now you're going to go ahead and confess for the mistakes? If Hashem's forgiving you for the deliberate sin and for the rebellious sins, you don't have to go ahead and ask regarding the mistakes. So they disagree. And rather, they hold the order was different. The confession was first, chatasi, I sinned by mistake. Then you get bigger. And not only that, I did deliberately. And not only that, I was even rebellious. I did lahachas. That I did lefanach in front of you, on me, your vesi, v'chulu, me and my family, etc. And say the Chama proved to you that's the word. V'chem David Oyma, we find in Tillim. David says, Chatanu, we sinned, which is Chet, Imma, we sinned with our fathers. Hevinu, deliberate. Hishanu, and we were wicked. V'chem Shlomo, Mesut, the Bishlam, says the Malacham Aleph. Chatanu, and the order here, the gear says actually, Hevinu, Rishanu, first Chet, then Avain, then Rishas. V'chem B'Daniel Oyma, says the Pasuk in Daniel. Chatanu, and the gear says, Vavinu, Rishanu, Muranu, first Chet, then Avain, then Merida. So therefore, it must be like we're saying chet is first, not last. Oh, say el ma'ashina amav Moshe, but you remain. You brought what did Moshe Rabbeinu say when he says leisi amav pesha v'chata? So why did Moshe Rabbeinu say oven and then pesha and then chata afterwards? Oh yeah, and I'm saying what Moshe Rabbeinu said. Amosh of Nekesh Boch, he said, Rabbeinu Shalayla, master of the world, b'shoshe yisrael chayt lefanach ha'vayisim shuv, when the Jewish people sin in front of you and they repent, aseilem zedonis kishkagayis, make the deliberate sins like they did it by mistake. So it's saying noisy oven vafasha bechata means to say make their oven vafasha like a chata, which is bishagi. So therefore they disagree. Now Amrav Mishmo Amrav, he says that what's the halacha? Halacha give a chacham. Halacha falls like the chachamim that yes, first we say chata first, which obviously like we're saying because you first want to do the mistakes first. Says Gemara, but why do you have to say halachas lechem? Pshita, obviously. You have to ram we always know when the individual disagrees with the rabbi, the halachas like the rabbi. Says Gemara, no matter what would you say, Mr. Tamid Ramei? Maybe the reason of Ramei is more logical. The Kumasai lekrad the Moshe, the pasuk of Moshe Rabbeinu supports that. Although they had pesukim too, but as Rashi explains, but with the pasuk of Moshe was the vidah v'yom kippurim itself, which is the huge gemamidus. Ashal rachamim. That pasuk is saying chatah last. So maybe that would seem to indicate like Rameir. Kamash Malan, then no, we don't say like Rameir because you're misunderstanding. Maybe he's just saying it should be like Chet. But of course, when we confess, our Chet is confessed first. Now the Gemara actually brings a story that Ahud Anoth has come into Rabbah. There was a Shlich Tzibba that was organizing his prayers. He was davening on Yom Kippurim in front of Rabbah, the order of the Avodas of the Kohen Gadol, because, and that's what we do, like the Pasas and the Yosheb and the Shama promise to the saying, we talk about the Avodah as if, and it brings like the Segulas on the Avodah itself. Vavik Rameir, and he did like Rameir, meaning to say when he did the Vida of the Kohen Gadol, he mentioned the Chet at the end. Amalai, they said to him, Shavkesh Rabbanu Abdiks Rameir, you're leaving the Pinner Rabbanu who say Chet is read and you like Rameir? Amalai, Rameir speaking, he says, I hold like Rameir, says the Shatz. Kedasibba Sevai Reisid the Moshe, this man Nisach. Ichzog under the Nisach doing the Avon, and he says, I hold like Rameir, because that's what it says in the Torah of Moshe Rabbeinu, where it says, by like we said, the Yigam Amidus, it says Chet at the end, and therefore he did the like his, the way he understood. Now, bring a source for this halacha. We said that in the Mishnah that the Kohen Gadol would come to his par, between his Beinu Mizvech, and he would do the confession. And how do we know that this, where does it say in the Torah that he did this Zidui? So talking about within the Braisa, when it talks about his par in the Torah, it says, V'chiper, it says, V'chiper ba'adoi ba'ad ve'isai, he will make an atonement for him and his family. What does that mean, V'chiper? V'chapar z'var makas v'adab, it talks about an atonement through words, which that's what Vidui is. Vidui is an atonement that happens through confession. Says the Braisa, Atam, V'chapar z'dam, do you really say this is atonement through words? Or you know, V'chapar z'dam, maybe it means an atonement, as it normally does, which is through the blood, by spraying the blood on his back of his par. Says the Braisa, already done, says, I'll qualify this. Nemar kan kapara, it says over here, by the power of the Kohen Gadol. It says kaparam. V'nem lahal, it says over there by the star Mishtaleach, the other, the he-goat that was sent off the cliff, it says over there kapara too. It says yom et chalef ne'ashem, it should stand alive in front of Hashem, l'chaparam. So ma kapara ha-mur-besar, just like when it talks about atonement by the he-goat. It's devarim, it's only words, because there was no dam. They didn't do any avodah with the star Mishtaleach, they threw it off the cliff. There was only the Kohen with Leon that he would do the confession of God's Klal Yisrael. Ah, kapar mo bepas. When he mentions kapar by the bull of the Kohen Gadol, it's also with words. Now, if you want to respond and refute this gezeirah shavah that I'm comparing the kapara of the par to the kapara of the sar, and to say that's not true, that the chiper here means regarding matan damim. However, but in mineu bay, in the parsha of the par itself, I can prove to you that it's not possible to say that, because Ari Oimer says in the pasuk v'hikra ba'aron es par achatas hashaloi. That Aaron will sacrifice, will bring near the bull of the chatzis that's his. And it says, V'chiper ba'adoi va'ad beisa. And it says, he'll atone for himself and for his family. And only later does it say, V'shachat is par chatzis. So obviously, you already said V'chiper ba'adoi before V'shachat, V'adam le'nishchat par. But the par wasn't slaughtered yet. Obviously, when it's toma kapara, it means a kapara with devar. Because how could you have kapara, which is with dam, and then say, you're shechting afterwards? It's impossible. Obviously, the kapara was when you did your confession, which was before the shechita. That's how you know. Says my vim nafshach lema. Why do you have to say if you want to say? Well, what would I have refuted the gzeirah shavah? I have to tell you another reason. What was wrong with that gzeirah shavah? And that says the gemara v'chitim. And maybe you're going to say to learn now when it says v'chiper by the power of the kohen gadol misar hanasim b'fnim. There's two seem to compare it to. How do you know? Maybe learn it out from the sar panimi where there it says v'chiper ala kodesh metumas b'nei yisrael with this kaparas b'dam. The power, what we call Hashem, that's atonement was after the Matan Damim written. And also, actually, the Sar Hashem didn't have a Vida anyway. So maybe learn it out from the Kapara that it says by the Sar Hanas Befnim, and that was obviously with Dam. Oh, you're right, so you're right. Not necessarily do we learn it from the Sar Lazazel, maybe we should learn it from the Sar Hashem, which there was with Dam. Sorry, and therefore I bring you a second raya, which is by his bull, it says V'chiper, which is V'adayin L'nish Chabal, like you said, it wasn't slaughtered yet. So obviously the Kapar was with Dvarim, was with the confession, that was the primary atonement that actually was coming with his Pap. Now, continue on top of Lamadayin Manaf, but the Gemara continues to qualify that we said in the Mishnah what he would say, oh no, Hashem, and he would say, says the Gemara Manayin Shema'ana, says the Braisa, how do you know that this confession had this word Ana in it? So says the Gemara, never can kapar, because it says over here, kapara, by the power of the Kohen Gadol. But never halam b'chayv, it says over there, by Har Sinai. when they had the Maisa Eagle, which was right after Matan Torah, it says Kapar. Like it says in Shemesh Lama Beis, Moshe Ben says, Ula Echab Ba'at Chazasa, maybe I'll atone for your sins. It says over the Kapar too. So Malahan Ba'ana, just like over there, it says, Ono Chato Amazeh, it says, Ono, Avkam Ba'ana, so also over here, we're in Xer Shav Kapara, also had the word Ono. Now, Menayin Shebashem, how do we know that it says, Ono Hashem? How do we know that here, by the Kohen Gadol, by his power, you're supposed to say, Ono Hashem, that it should be with God's name? Oh, says the Gemara, because Nemekan Kapara says over here Kapara, but Nemekan Be'egla Arufa Kapara. It says by the decapitated calf, again, when we find a dead person, we don't know who killed him, we bring a Egla Arufa. It says over there Kapara, it says Kapala Amchi Yisrael Hashem Adisa Hashem. Oh, so Malah Hashem, just like over there, it has Hashem's name. Avkam Hashem, so over here, it has Hashem's name. Now, Amabai has an interesting question. He says, Bishleim Achayiv Me'egla Arufa Le'yot. He says, what you just did was, the word Kapara, it says by the Kohen Gadol, by his power. It says by the Egla Arufa, the word Kapara, and it says by Harasina, by the Eagle Kapara. So you learned out the Kohen Gadol from Chayriv, from the Eagle, and you learned it out from the Egla Arufa. But what's with learning out Chayriv and Egla Arufa from each other? They both have the word Kapara too. So that's why he says, Bishlam Chayriv Egla Arufa Loyal. We're not learning out what Moshe Rabbeinu did by Harasinai from the Egla Arufa to say that Moshe Rabbeinu should have mentioned Hashem's name over there, just like it has by Egla Arufa, because my Dahavahava, what already was. So you can't go back and done. Which the way the Tzitzis Hashem says, the Moshe Rabbeinu said whatever he wanted to say, and whatever that means, it's like we're not learning going back in time. So we're not asking that we should have learned out from the Egla Arufa to say that Moshe Rabbeinu went and he used Hashem's name. But Egla Arufa tells Mechayev, but why do you learn out the Halacha of Egla Arufa, which is Negeya now, that you should learn from Har Sinai by the Egel, and you should require to say the word Ana when they say the phrase by the Chachach Meir, when they bring the Egel Arufa, you have to say the word Ana. Because just like it says Kapar by Chayir, when they had the word Ana, and says if you're going to say, yeah, maybe you're right, but Egel Arufa, they said Ana, you can't say that. But now we learned explicitly in the Mishnah Sefer Saita of Membam and Aleph, when it talks about the Mice of the Egel Arufa, it says, Kahanim, I mean, what would the Kahanim say? The Pasuk in Devarim. Kapal Amchi Yisrael, atone for you people, the Jewish people. Vilba Ana, look, come, it doesn't say the word Ana. But why not? It says Kapar by Chayir, it says Kapar by Egel Arufa, you should learn out. Just like it says Ana, something over here. Says the Gemara, Kasha, yeah, that definitely is a difficulty. Why you wouldn't say it requires the word Ana. So we're discussing today's daf in Yuma, daf Lamed Vav. We have the halacha of the Mishnah. He said that he came to his cow, and it was between Ulam Mizbech, which we said that specifically the Blazer of Shimon, who holds that area is going to be considered as Safen, which we said, however, it technically could also be like Rebbe. And so why don't we say it's Bakula Azav, it's going like Rebbe? Because of the weakness of Kohen Gadol. Because anyways, you have to say that Kohen Gadol Shimon that we had in Ulam Mizbech, which a primary one we agree would be Al Yerech Mizbech Tzafayna. But yeah, because he has to bring the blood into the Eichel, so we brought it as close as possible. But again, it's not like according to those rules, it has to be Al Yerech Mizbech, literally. So it could be like Rebbe Shimon, or even like that of Rebbe. We said that the head was to the south and the face was toward the west. How's that possible that the head was one way and the face was the other way? Because they would actually bend the head. Now, why didn't they do it just directly? Because it might be Yarbitz Glolim, and that's not appropriate to have the back facing towards the Mizbech. And he would be Mizvah, then he said, Oh, Hashem, and he would say, Baruch Shem Kavayim Ma'uzam, when they heard God's name mentioned. Now, the truth is, we said by all karbanas, by of sin, that you would do this idea of vidui. Now, we had specifically machlokes around Lekach Kapeya and the Velo, if that's considered Lavanitik Lasei, because it's only written after the Lav, if that would be also Mashma, the Mikaro, or that was one interpretation, the other interpretation was that they have machlokes actually regarding Tazir. Is that actually Menatikit? Is that saying now, or is that saying regarding the past? That was two interpretations, Machlokes Rizik Lili and that of the Kiva. Right, Machlokes regarding the Seder of the confession regarding Chatasi, does that come first or come last? Because on the one hand, you find many Pesukim holding it comes last or it comes first. So the Chacham said, no, of course Chatasi comes first, because B'Shagi, and then you say B'Mason, then you say B'Meridim. This is B'Mesha B'Mesha Chet at the end means to say it should be like a Chet, that the Zdainis are becoming like Shkagis. We said regarding his bull, it says, Chiper, what does that mean? It means Kapaz Devarim with words. He should confess, like we said in the Halacha of Mishnah. How do you know that? Either because, like it says, by the Samar Shaleach, and there the Kapar was with words, or because it says Shechita afterwards. Obviously, it's not the Kapar's Damim, because you can't do Kapar of Damim and then Shechita afterwards. And we also said it has to have the word Ana, which we learn out from Chayiv by the Eagle, where Moshe Ben says, says Ana, and there it said all these, it says Kapar over there. And so too, that we know it has to have Hashem's name, which we learn from Egel Arufa, which also says Kapara, and you have Hashem's name. Thank you for any time for hosting us.